The AJA, Americans of Japanese Ancestry Veterans, were given a hero's welcome when they began returning to Hawaii in 1946. Men of the 442nd Regimental Combat Team, 100th Battalion, and MIS Military Intelligence Service remain a cohesive group. A clubhouse for the 442nd was built in McCully and became a gathering place for war buddies. The veterans themselves reflect those who contributed to Hawaii's post-war success story. The men, then in their prime, started new businesses or returned to family businesses started by their Issei first-generation parents.
After the war, yeah, there were a lot of people whose families had started the business, and now you have the sons coming back who've been exposed to everything the world has to offer instead of being just from Hawaii.
They came back, the world was never going to be the same for them again. They were not going to go back to the plantation era.
Because of their war experience, look, they had leadership ability, a lot more education, broad-mindedness, which were cosmopolitan in their world. They had a worldview that went beyond the shores of Hawaii, so, and they had ambition.
The AJA veterans fought a war for an equal and better society and returned to their family businesses, started new businesses, or found new careers. But they needed real and tangible power, politically and economically. On the surface, they seemed to have erased racial prejudice, but there was still discrimination against the AJA, even in Hawaii.
Some of these men, including my grandfather, had been corresponding with some of the American Japanese ancestry in the 442nd. And some of them were writing letters, and they were in hospital beds in Italy, recovering from their injuries in the war. And they're writing letters saying stuff like, okay, we risk our lives fighting for the United States, but what kind of Hawaii are we going to come back to? Do we have to go back to the plantation?
For most of us, it was inconceivable to go back to the plantation to do menial labor. As Sakai Takahashi told me in the hospital, he says, no, we can't go back to that. We've paid our dues. And so we decided to do something about it.
It started in 1954, the Democratic Political Revolution, when the Democrats took over the state legislature, but it culminated in 1962. Because 1962, when my grandfather became governor, he was then able to pass his agenda, which broke the Big Five's control over the state.
I met Jack Burns for the first time. And Jack Burns started asking a lot of questions about my feeling for Hawaii. And it was when that, after the, about 15 minutes, told me to run for office. I first started talking to somebody else. I turned around to see, and then he said, look, you.
Not enough can be said about the GI Bill of Rights, which was signed into law by President Franklin Roosevelt on June 22, 1944. The veterans reaped its benefits, continuing on with higher education, which set them on a solid path for their futures.
If you look at the record, number one, we took advantage of the GI Bill. Like a flood, an avalanche. In my company, I think I really did.
sharing their rights.
Those of us who took advantage of the GI Bill, and I think most of us did, that made a huge difference in what we were able to do.
Fujio Matsudo taught engineering at top academic institutions, then became director of the State Department of Transportation, UH president, and finally president of the Japan Institute of Management Sciences. Keiji Kawakami, who served in Italy and France, also took advantage of the GI Bill and attended New York University, graduating with an MBA focused on marketing. He returned to Hawaii and started Iolani Sportswear in 1953. Jackson Morisawa, another 442nd vet, worked alongside Kawakami as his textile designer.